watching the days go by. I got you on my mind, and I need you by my side. But it's gonna take some time.
Hello, family. I am the Pastor Chef Mike Newton. This is The Main Ingredient, and welcome to our kitchen. We have a very exciting show for you today. We have my friend, my brother, my mentor, the man who prepared the table for me to encounter Christ, Pastor Mick Veach, joining us here today. And we also have Lawrence here. He's the CEO of Core, the company that helps us produce this show and the other content that's involved with The Main Ingredient. So Lawrence, tell us a little bit about your company and what you guys do.
Well, thank you. So I'm the co-founder and CEO of Core. We are a company that helps small business owners, startups, entrepreneurs, nonprofits do things like accounting, graphic design, and even production. So at Core, if you're interested in any of the services that we offer, you can go to outsourcecore.com or email info@outsourcecore.com. And I'll be glad to talk to you there. At Core, it's possible.
That's amazing. So let me just tell you this. Out of all of those things that he said they do more than that. Because like this show wasn't even in the plans when we first started talking. But we thought about it. God gave us the vision and then he gave us the provision. And now here we are doing a show. So today we're going to be preparing some delicious food.
Yes.
And having some good conversation. So Mick, we know that you led me to Christ. You've been an integral part in my walk with Jesus. But other than that, tell us a little bit more about who you are, what you do, and what's the passion behind why you do what you do.
Thanks, Michael. It's good to be here with you all. Obviously, I am a pastor, but more importantly, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. That's the clear thing that I want to communicate to all of you. Also, I'm a father of three adult children, 26, 25, and 23. Got that right. And been married many years to my wife, Melanie. And we live right here in Kentwood, Michigan, Pastor Kentwood Community Church. I'm passionate about seeing people understand what it means to follow Jesus, regardless of where they've come from, what they've experienced, whether that is in Kentwood or whether that is in Timbuktu. It doesn't matter to me.
I know, that's right. So I'm excited that you're here with us today and you decided to come and cook up some good food with us. Now, I know you're not a chef.
No,
right?
No.
Out of the many things that I know about
He's
you, I know
chef.
You're not a chef.
I am not.
But today we're going to, we're going to join together and we're going to cook some good food. And we're going to test that I'm not a chef theory. So today we're preparing some chicken Alfredo. And I just want to share this with you. The reason why we're preparing this dish today is because not too long ago, we were in Naperville, Illinois. And we were at a restaurant. I'm not going to say the name. And it just so happens that a few of us ordered chicken Alfredo. And Lawrence said that chicken Alfredo was his favorite dish.
Oh,
and then he mentioned one of them. And he mentioned this other restaurant, which I'm not going to say any names,
uh-oh,
that they had the best chicken Alfredo. Now, I don't know why I took that as a challenge, right? I don't know why I took that as, okay, now I'm in competition, but pray for me, guys. So today, my challenge is to make the best chicken Alfredo, ooh, that Lawrence has ever tasted.
Uh-oh. And
that's, I'm going to add a special twist. Now, as I always mention, as chefs, we don't create these new dishes out of the air, right? What we do is we take something that has already been created and we add our own special twist to it. So this chicken Alfredo will be made with my own special twist, and I'm excited to get involved and get started with this. So, you guys ready?
I'm ready.
Let's do it.
All right. So the first thing we want to do is, Lawrence, why don't you grab the butter, and we're going to get our pot on the stove. Now, what we want to do with our butter is we want to start melting our butter, and we want to make sure that as we're melting our butter, that we don't burn the butter, right? Because what we're making now is a bechamel sauce, and a bechamel is one of the five mother sauces. It's a white sauce, and so we want to keep our sauce white and creamy, and we don't want it to have that burnt flavor. So Lawrence, why don't you go ahead and add the butter? And so as you're adding the butter.
All of it?
Yes, all of the butter. And whisk it around so that it melts pretty quickly. Yeah, there's a whisk right over here. And then what you're going to do is I'm going to turn this fire up just a little bit, but not too much. What you're going to do is now you're going to add the chicken base. So first we're adding our butter. Then we're adding our chicken base. And what we're doing is we're making our bechamel sauce. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Pastor Mick, excuse me.
Yeah,
I'm going to have him add the garlic.
Oh, yes. Good thing I'm not eating it right now. Put it right here?
Yes.
All right.
And so he's adding the chicken base and he's adding the garlic. Now, normally I would use chicken consomme, but for the sake of time, we're just going to use chicken base. It works the same. It has the same flavor profile, but it's quicker. And if I'd have been here making this chicken consomme, we'll be here forever. And I know you guys don't want to do that. So as he's adding that, what we're going to do is we're going to cook this to aroma. Now, what that means is he's going to cook it just until the garlic starts to smell. So as he puts his nose over the pan and he smells the garlic.
I can smell it.
You can smell the garlic. Now, what we don't want to do is brown the garlic, right? We don't want to brown the garlic and it'll add like that popcorn-y taste. We don't want to do that. So we just want to cook the garlic to aroma. Now, after everything is incorporated, we want to now add, Lawrence, our heavy whipping cream. And heavy whipping cream, yes. So add that in there. And then as he adds the heavy whipping cream, we're going to let that come to a boil. Then
all
we're
going
to simmer it.
The entire amount?
Yes. Yeah. Just keep adding. Add with one hand and whisk with the other hand so you can marry all the ingredients together. Yeah. So these guys are doing a great job. And I appreciate the help because normally when I'm at home cooking by myself, I'm cooking by myself. But sometimes, you know, a leader needs to pass off tasks to other people to do things. And while we're doing other things. And so I'm passing these tasks off to Pastor Mick and to Lawrence while I get other things ready. And so while they're doing that, let me come over here and I'll turn up our fire for our pan because we're going to cook our chicken there. So as we're talking about leadership and passing off leadership, I still remember a lot of the things that you taught me about being a good leader. And one of those things that you taught me about being a good leader is to never be afraid to let somebody else win. And I noticed that, and you can speak to this as well, I noticed that as, you know, you were walking this discipleship path with me, that you kept putting things in front of me to say yes to Jesus to. You kept putting me in position, right, where I could step up and just live out the calling that God had on my life. And so you taught me that a leader is never afraid to let the next person win. And you also taught me this very, very important lesson that a good leader raises up other leaders. And so, you know, with that, just speak a little bit about other good qualities or marks of a good leader.
Sure, Michael. I think that we've overcomplicated it in a lot of ways because we all lead something. Every single one of us lead at certain points in our life, but I think a quality of a good leader is somebody that's always wanting to learn themselves. As soon as you stop learning, you stop leading, and life is so full of so many different, like even this right now, being able to watch you do this and learn because I'm not a cook.
Right.
It's a totally foreign thing to me and say, oh, I can go home and tell my wife. I actually learned something from Pastor Michael today about cooking, and leaders are always curious and as it relates to that, and I think that a good leader also is, as they're learning, there's a sense of true sense of security, because you already said the first thing is that when you're secure, you want other people to win. I don't know if you remember me telling you, but when we were getting to learn about how to grow in our faith, the one thing I told you is that they're not going to remember you anyways.
Michael. Right.
So if you, once you realize nobody's going to remember you, then you're actually free to be who you are and allow other people to be a hero maker. Let others win and not, and you should, if you live a life that way as you lead, you're going to always have a greater impact, right?
Yeah. I was talking with a friend of mine, his name is John Freed, and it was amazing that you said the hero maker, because he was like, Mike, you know, the work that you guys are doing at TMI and the work that you guys are doing at CORE is you're actually making heroes, you know? And I was like, I thought back, I was like, well, I learned, you know, from a person who was one of the best leaders that I've ever had the opportunity to be in relationship with. And I truly believe that we spent a lot of time in the Word, but what you did for me was you actually modeled what it looked like to one be a leader and to one be a believer, right? And to follow Christ. And I think it was living out that model that helped me catch on, because, you know, I didn't grow up in the church, you know, and I think it helped for me to catch on a lot quicker than it would have had we just did
you know, the reading and the studying and things like that.
Didn't Jesus do that, though? Like, with his disciples, he modeled it.
Yes.
And didn't just say, go do it. And I believe, like, in our world today, people are looking for authentic leadership are people that actually believe what they're actually saying. And I believe we don't give people enough credit. I believe they can see through people pretty quickly, whether they're just going through the motions or they're just giving you the principles, but at the end of the day, they don't believe it themselves.
Yeah.
But, and I'd say the second thing is that when you're able to lead other people, you have to be comfortable in your own skin. That's not as easy as it sounds, is it?
Right.
I think all of us try to compare and think, if I was just this, or I had that skill, or I was could sing like Lawrence, or whatever, then I would truly be able to be a great leader. But the reality is God created each of us to be who we are. And once we truly figure that out and understand our identities in Christ, it is a game changer.
Yeah. Yeah, because I know that early on, right, I tried to, the Bible says, follow me as I follow Christ. And I followed you as you followed Christ. But I found out that I saw myself trying to do things the way that Mick did them. And you encouraged me, no, Michael, you know, you have your own unique gifts and callings. So be yourself, right, and lead how God has prompted you to lead. And I think that played a huge role in developing me into the leader that I am today. So what we're going to do is now we're going to transition over here. And what we're doing is we're cooking our chicken. We're going to sear our chicken really nice. Now, what we'll do is, as we sear it, we're going to finish it in the oven. And I need to turn my sauce up so that can bring to a boil. Going to hit it with a little lemon. That's going to add some flavor to it. So, put our chicken in there. And we have the magic of television. Voila.
Wow.
So, we have some chicken already prepared. And so, as our sauce heats up, what we're going to do now is we're going to add our Parmesan cheese, because what we want to do is we want to thicken the sauce up. So this is our Alfredo sauce, and we're going to thicken our sauce up. But what we're going to do is we're going to add the cheese slowly, right, because we don't want it to get too thick. Now, we can always add stuff to it, but we can never take stuff out. So I'm going to add a little pepper to this. And I'm not measuring this because I've done this enough times to know when to stop.
Kind of like how to ride a bike, you always know, huh?
Yes, absolutely. But we have the recipe for those who haven't done it that many times, and you can add just the right amount. So I'm going to add the pepper. Then I'm going to add my salt.
Is the sauce the most important part of the dish?
So the sauce is the most important part of the dish. It is the star of the dish, and the chicken is the co-star.
Oh.
And the pasta is just the supporting cast.
What are you putting in right now, salt?
So I'm putting in salt. This is actually Himalayan salt, but you'll probably use regular table salt. So I'm going to stir that up, and then as that heats up, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add, yes. And I'm going to add it and stir it as I add it. Stir it and as I add it. And we'll let that heat up.
Is this a dish that's more difficult to produce on a mass quantity? Is it easy?
No, this is easy. So, like, you can feed a family of eight, if you had a family of eight, for roughly $30.
Wow.
Yeah, off of this dish. And you can eat off of it for 2 days, if you like leftovers. My wife will tell you that I don't really eat leftovers. And before you say anything, Pastor Mick is going to tell you that I'm a food diva. But yeah, so yeah. So we're going to get that going.
He works at it.
I'm trying, guys. Pray for me now. Pray for me. I struggle with that.
How often do you cook this dish?
Well, with my catering service, I try to do a pasta dish at least once a month. And so it'll either be chicken Alfredo or baked spaghetti or something else. But so I'm cooking this dish at least once a month or once every other month.
Nice.
A good friend of mine, his name is Chef John. He's passed away right now. He taught me this recipe right here. And it's been one of my favorite recipes to make. And so here's the twist. Now, I'm adding this Parmesan cheese. And this will give you your unique, or your, should I say, your original Alfredo sauce. But my twist is I'm going to add some lemon zest. Mm. And the reason why I add the lemon zest is this is going to give it its own little kick, right? Now, what we want to do when we're cooking is we want to create a flavor profile that ultimately ends up being a flavor explosion in the mouth of the person who eats it. So when they bite into this dish, they'll taste one flavor profile from the chicken. They'll taste another flavor profile from the Alfredo sauce. And then those two flavor profiles will combine to create a flavor explosion.
You know, this is a really tempting day since I didn't tell you I'm in the middle of fasting.
Oh,
and the smells of this is just heightened. If you've ever fasted, you realize that your smell and your taste is heightened. And this is really smelling good.
And so I'm going to transfer my chicken over here to the cutting board.
What's the usual prep time and cook time for
all together with this dish right here? If you can get your sauce going, maybe 30 minutes and you're eating, you know, because with the way society is going right now, with everything that we're involved in, especially if you have kids, with getting them to and from everything that they got going on and working yourself, right? We don't have as much time to spend in the kitchen as our grandparents did. Right. You know, they'd be in the kitchen all day, right? But now, since we're so busy, we have to create efficient meals, and we have to do it in an efficient time. So now what I'm going to do is, this is just a garnish that I'm making. And what I have here is I have some lemons. Lawrence, if you want to pass me that sriracha. And so we're going to let this heat up really, really hot, because we're going to sear our lemon in the sriracha, and it'll be just a garnish. So let's set that here. And while our sauce is heating up, and now that's the consistency right there. That's the consistency right there. So Lawrence, if you want to grab the sweet peas and the carrots. And the reason why I added, this is really funny. You may get a kick out of this. The reason why I added the sweet peas and the carrots, because the chef who taught me how to make this, Alfredo, he didn't eat vegetables.
Wow.
And so I had to trick him. I had to trick him into eating vegetables. And this was his favorite dish. So what I started doing was, I started adding vegetables to the Alfredo, and he had no choice.
Did he eat
that's
it?
A good
yeah, he ate it. He ate it. Yeah, so we're going to add.
Did he confess that he was okay to eat the vegetables in the dish?
Oh yeah, he loved it. He loved it. And we actually, when we opened up the restaurant in Birmingham, Michigan, and our pasta Alfredo, we added the carrots and the green bean, sweet peas to that dish.
Wow.
So what we're going to do is, we're going to add our noodles. So because we want our noodles to cook in the sauce and absorb all of that flavor. All of that flavor.
And it's are the noodles pre-cooked?
The noodles are pre-cooked. Yep. So I cook the noodles to al dente, which means I just cook them until they're firm, but not too hard. And then they'll soften up the rest of the way inside of the sauce. So now that we have our sauce boiling, we're going to turn it down a little bit and let it simmer. And then we'll get into the meat. Yeah, that looks good. That's right good. There. Can you smell it?
Go ahead. I can smell it. Mm-hmm. Lawrence wants to stir it because he can smell it.
Yeah. So as I pass off this to Lawrence, and we're talking about leadership, this brings me to our devotional for the day. And most historians will agree that Moses was the greatest leader in the Bible. Mm-hmm. And if we look at Numbers 11, verses 16 through 17, it says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Gather before me 70 men who are recognized as elders and leaders of Israel. Bring them to the tabernacle to stand there with you. I will come down and take you there. I will take some of the spirit that is upon you, and I will put the spirit upon them also. They will bear the burden of the people along with you, so you will not have to carry it alone.'" So here's the organic truth. Most of us as leaders, we experience burnout when we try to take on too much. We notice from this story, if we were to go back, Moses experienced burnout because he was taking on too much. Now, here he was leading these people out of bondage and into freedom, and there was a lot of complaining going on, and he was doing everything, and God was saying, no, look, I want to show you how to really be a leader, and how you really be a leader is that you raise up other leaders like Pastor Mick was talking about earlier. But sometimes we could take on too much because we don't feel what? People are qualified to do it as good as we can do it. Or we don't pour into them the way that we're supposed to pour into them, right? And so it's our role as leaders to develop these people who are working with us or working side by side with us for this leadership.
Isn't it funny, may I interject, that when you talked about burnout, that burnout truly comes from pride.
Oh.
When you believe you're the only one that can do it, and therefore you put too much on your plate, and as a result, you end up losing the whole task before you simply because you think nobody can do it like you.
Mm-hmm. And I experienced a lot of that in my cooking profession because I didn't think that the people who were working with me were good enough or strong enough to do the things the way that I could do them. Or I would think that only I can do it the way that it needs to be done. And what we also understand is that leaders must learn to follow and serve first. So we took a look at Moses, who God called him to bring the 70. But when we look at the 70, he said who you already know to be leaders, right? So they were already doing the work. They were already following and serving. And then God, they were doing it without the title. You gave me the book one time called Leading Without the Position or something like that. And so they were doing the work without the position. And I remember as you were walking this journey of faith with me at Mosaic, right, a lot of the things that you were having me do are the things that I do now as the assistant pastor. And I don't know if that was by design, but it really helped me out because now that I'm in the position, right, the position means absolutely nothing to me because I was already doing the work without the position. So leaders must learn to follow and to serve first.
Well, I think what you're saying is really critical, Michael, in that if you're doing it out of the pureness of your heart, it will be sustainable. But if you're doing it to try to elevate yourself in stature and professional advancement, it's not that those things are necessarily wrong, but if that's the motive, you get the title, to get the money, to get the fame, if that is your goal, you will always be disappointed at the end of the day. But if you're doing it truly, like you were at Mosaic, doing it out of the core of who you are, then it becomes more natural when you're actually given the formal position.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I think the third thing that we understand about the mark of a true leader is leaders understand that leadership comes from God. Leadership comes from God. Like, we don't wake up one morning and say, you know what? I think I'm going to be a leader. You know, God gives us, one, the anointing, but he calls us into leadership. Right. And if you just want to talk a little bit about how you got to a position of leadership or in your story from, you know, I believe it was what, 1985? Was it 1982 to now we're in 2021. Right. And just the journey that you went through and becoming the leader that you are today.
Well, I think at the end of the day, it's not about aspiring to be a leader. I think it's about aspiring to what to do what God wants you to do. Mm-hmm. So in my own journey, it's been very clear. I never aspired, as you already know, I never aspired to be a pastor or a speaker or a missionary or a church planner or an influencer. I just what was more drawing to me was always to actually have an impact. That something was before me that was so motivational that I was going to do whatever it took to actually see that accomplished. So whether it was sharing the gospel or helping refugees in another country or getting involved with the local church and serving people that have given them. Because what I get really excited about in all of this is that you talked about when you are training new cooks or new chefs. Mm-hmm. It's the same, I think, in leadership. It's not where somebody's at. It's where you see they could be. Mm. And that's what your and our relationship was. It was like, it's not where you were at when I noticed you. It's where I believe God was taking you to be a part of that process is actually more fulfilling as a leader than any other. And so throughout my life, it's never been about trying to aspire to a title or a position. Now, I've had a lot of those, but simply because I've been drawn to that passion that God's given me and that I never limited God. because I don't know what you think about yourself and your past, but for me, I was the one that nobody would ever guess would do it. Mm-hmm. You're right. Speech impediment, can't pronounce various words, from a divorced background, and nobody in my family ever went to college. You name all those things. And so I was the one that nobody's, that everybody would say, he will, they label us, right? This is what his life is going to be. But I would say that there was another individual, just like me in your life, there was somebody that came into my life and said, hey, I believe in you. God wants to use your life. And I begin to believe it. Do we believe that our life counts? And what we're doing here today is a testimony that God desires to make our lives count on purpose, and you're living that out. It's thrilling to be here with you.
I want to share this with you guys because I have him on here for a reason. And he doesn't
not because I'm a good cook.
Not because he's a good cook. But, you know, he doesn't like when I do this. But if it had not been for my relationship with Pastor Mick, there's no telling if I would be in a relationship with Christ. I want to say that again because I want you to understand. My relationship with Pastor Mick pointed me towards a relationship with Christ. Now, Pastor Mick didn't save me. He pointed me towards the one who could save. Pastor Mick gave me opportunities, right, to say yes to Christ so that I would grow closer to Christ. Pastor Mick saw something in me 5 years ago that I wasn't able to see in myself. And now I see it. And now that I'm in a position of leadership, I'm looking into other people's lives and seeing if I can see something in them that they can't see in themselves. And so I want to thank you so much, Pastor Mick, for joining us today. And I want to leave you guys with this. Those of you who are leaders or who are aspiring leaders and feel God calling you into leadership, ask yourself this question before you assume your role. Am I okay with seeing other people win? Am I okay with seeing other people win? Do I have the ability to see into people what they can't see in themselves, right? And do I have the ability to raise up other leaders? You know, there's a bunch of other things, but I think if we can get those three right, and do I understand that leadership comes from God? Leadership comes from God. It's something that he calls us to. If we can get those things right, and we can start investing in other people, investing time in other people, then I think we have the ability to change our world. What about you?
I'm 100% behind what you just said. I believe dead straight on what God is saying to us today.
So again, thank you so much. Thank you, Lawrence.
No problem.
We're going to wrap up this segment of the show. We're going to have our good food, and we're going to leave you with some closing remarks.
Well, thank you so much for joining us once again. It's been a privilege. It's always a privilege to be able to be in relationship with you, have community with you. If you want to connect with The Main Ingredient, you can go to yourmaingredient.com. You can also email us through the same website for more information or just more content. Be sure to like this, comment, or even share it with your friends and family. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Joining us. I really appreciate you tuning in each and every week whenever you're watching this. Feel free to like, comment, or even share this. Comment with the prayer request below. This next song is just talking about bringing everything that we have to the altar, giving it all over to God. And that's what I want you to do this morning or whenever you're watching this. I just want you to surrender. Bring it all to God. Lay it down on the altar. That's all we have.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born within. the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Yeah, yeah. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Oh, trade sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus. Come to the altar, come to the altar. Father's arms, arms are open. Forgiveness was bought. Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Watching the days go by, I got you on my mind. Yeah, I need you by my side, but it's gonna take some time.